Hi, good morning everyone. So today we are going to move to the last part of semiconductor devices, which are nothing but optoelectronic junction devices. Optoelectronic junction devices. So what it means devices in which PN junction diode is used. We are going to use a PN junction diode in which what happens? Opto means light, photo means light. So opto means light, optoelectronic. Electronic means nothing but electric charge carriers like electrons or holes which can produce current. So in one word, optoelectronic junction devices are the devices in which we are going to use a PN junction diode, where opto means light is going to convert into current, or light is going to produce charge carriers, nothing but electrons and holes. So devices in which PN junction diode is used, where opto means light is going to convert to produce charge carriers which can generate current. In such a way, we are going to define optoelectronic junction devices. These optoelectronic junction devices are three in number. Basically, we can use three things as optoelectronic junction devices. The first one is called photodiode. Second one is called LED, LED light emitting diode. And the third one, which we can use in our regular domestic uses, nothing but a solar cell. So these three are the best examples where we are going to convert light into charge carriers or light into electricity. So we can discuss each one in detail. The first one, what we are going to call it as photodiode. So photodiode means diode. So we are going to use a PN junction diode. This diode should be in terms of reverse bias. It should be in reverse bias. Already in PN junction diode we discussed the graph which contains two regions, forward bias and reverse bias. If you look at the reverse bias, nature of the graph is in such a way. This current is called saturation current. This current, constant flow of current, is called saturation current. So photodiode is a PN junction diode in reverse bias. We have to use PN junction diode here only in reverse bias. We should not use in forward bias. So PN junction diode should be in reverse bias, where photo, already we discussed opto, photo are the words which explains the meaning called light, in which light is going, or light energy is going to convert into current, or light energy is going to produce charge carriers. If charge carriers are nothing but electrons and holes, if electrons and holes combine, it produces current. So in one word, photodiode is a PN junction diode in reverse bias, where photo means light, light energy is going to produce charge carriers, or light energy is going to produce current. In such a way, which current means this diode is in reverse bias. In reverse bias, we have a current called as saturation current. So this light energy is going to increase saturation current or to produce charge carriers. Simple word, photodiode, which is a PN junction diode in reverse bias, where photo means light is going to convert into electrical energy. Light is going to convert into current or saturation current, or light is going to produce charge carriers. All depends on each other. If charge carriers are produced, electrons and holes are produced, they produce current. Which current? Being reverse bias, you can generate a saturation current. In such a way, we are going to define photodiode, which is a PN junction diode in reverse bias, where light energy is going to convert into electrical energy, or light energy is going to produce charge carriers, or light energy is going to produce saturation current. In such a way, we can define different definitions for a photodiode. Coming to the construction of photodiode. Just if you look at the construction of photodiode. So photodiode, what it contains? It contains a PN junction diode. So we are going to take a PN junction diode. It should be in reverse bias. So in order to make it reverse bias, P should be connected to negative and N should be connected to positive. So this is a battery. Making PN junction diode in reverse bias is nothing but connecting P to negative terminal and N to positive terminal. Circuit also contains a load resistance. And we are going to use a device to measure current, which is microammeter. This is going to be called as microammeter. Microammeter, ammeter, galvanometer, multimeter, these are all devices to measure current. In order to measure small current, we have to use galvanometer. In order to produce or to measure large current, we have to use ammeter. So ammeter is a device used to measure large current. So the circuit contains a PN junction diode, which is connected in a reverse bias. In reverse bias, P should be connected to negative and N should be connected to positive. The circuit also contains a load resistance RL along with a device called microammeter to measure current. So this is the complete construction of a photodiode. Now coming to its working, how this photodiode works. What we discussed, photo means light. Light should be converted into electrical energy. Electrical energy is nothing but current. So light should be converted into current. So for that sake, what I am going to do? Photo means light. So we are going to send light, which are also called photons. Light is that light particles are called photons. So you are going to send light in form of photons on the PN junction diode. If you send light on the PN junction diode, just apply the concept to band theory of solids. In band theory of solids, what happens? Whenever some light energy is allowed to fall, automatically this is valence band, this is conduction band. So whenever photons or light is allowed to fall on PN junction diode, the electrons in the valence band absorb the energy. The electron in the valence band absorb this energy, and this electron will move to conduction band. Whenever the electron moves to conduction band, it produces a vacancy called as hole. So whenever light energy in form of photons falls on PN junction diode, which is in reverse bias, the electrons in valence band absorb the energy and moves to conduction band, leaving a small gap called as hole. So electron is formed in conduction band, hole is formed in valence band. So electron hole pairs are formed, automatically it leads to flow of current. Such flow of current is called as photocurrent. Such flow of current is called as photo current. Photo means light. Due to light, we are going to develop some current. Hence, it is called as photo current. And one more point is, due to electric field between P and N sites. Due to electric field between P and N. In P, which is positive, majority charge carriers are holes and minority charge carriers are electrons. So, all the minority charge carriers which are electrons will move towards N side. In the same way, N means negative. Having majority charge carriers as electrons and minority charge carriers as holes. So, the holes which are minority charge carriers in N will move towards P. So, in both sides, the minority charge carriers will move to their opposite ends. From P side, electrons being minority charge carriers will move towards N. Whereas in N region, which are holes as the minority charge carriers, they move towards P. Whenever in such a way, electrons from P, holes from N will move to their opposite ends. Then also, an EMF, electromotive force, or voltage is developed. This voltage leads to flow of current, and that current can be measured by using a microammeter. In such a way, using two regions, we are going to generate current in case of photodiode. So once again, we will recall the points. Photodiode. Photodiode is a PN junction diode, which should be in reverse bias, where photo means light. Light is going to produce electron hole pairs, or light is used to produce current. So, we are going to take a PN junction diode, which should be connected in reverse bias, P2 negative, N2 positive. The circuit also contains load resistance along with a microammeter. Ammeter means a device used to measure large current. So what happens whenever light of energy E is equal to h mu in form of photons falls on the PN junction diode? This energy is absorbed by the electrons in valence band and move to conduction band. Due to this, a hole is created in the valence band. So, electron hole pairs are formed which produces some current. Such current is called photocurrent. In such a way, we can produce current by transferring electron from band to band. So, electron hole pairs are formed and so leads to current. Second reason to produce current is whenever an electric field is applied in the PN junction diode, the minority charge carriers means holes in N, electrons in P will move to their opposite ends. Only minority charge carriers. Why? PN junction diode is working in reverse bias. In reverse bias, current flows only due to minority charge carriers. So for that sake, minority charge carriers from P will move towards N and minority charge carriers from N will move towards P automatically due to the movement of electrons and holes from both the sides. Current is or voltage or EMF, electromotive force, EMF is produced, which is also called as voltage. Due to this voltage, current flows through load resistance and that current can be measured by microammeter. In such a way, jumping the electron from valence band to conduction band and forming a hole can produce current called as photocurrent. And the second reason to produce current is by applying an electric field. So the minority charge carriers will move from both the sides and responsible for the flow of current due to production of EMF or voltage. In such a way, light energy is going to convert into electrical energy, which is current. So in the case of photodiode, in such a way we are going to convert light in terms of electrical energy. What is the use of photodiode? Why we have to use photodiode means it is the device which detects optical signals. Optics means light. Study of light is called optics. So this photodiode can easily detect optical signals, and it is used to detect both the visible and invisible radiations. Both the seen radiations and the unseen radiations can be easily detected, and it is used in fan switching circuits. Now you are going to make a circuit related to fan, automatically in such circuits we are going to use photodiodes, and this can be also used in cameras to detect the light intensity. With how much pixel camera, how much megapixel intensity the light is going to move from the cameras. In such a way, these photodiodes can be used to detect optical signals, to detect visible and invisible radiations. It is also used to detect the intensity of light in cameras, and also used in fan switching circuits. In such a way, the photodiode can be useful in a number of ways. And finally, to explain the graph of photodiode. So if you look at the graph of photodiode, photodiode is a PN junction diode which works only in reverse bias. So we are going to take the graph. This is voltage in forward bias, voltage in reverse bias, current in forward bias, current in reverse bias. The most important point which we are going to discuss in graph is, when light falls on photodiode, current is produced. When light in form of photons falls on the PN junction diode, current is produced. Still, if light in form of photons, also if not sent on the PN junction diode, even if you are not sending, even photons cannot fall on the PN junction diode, still we can produce some current. Such current is called dark current. So what is dark current means? It is the current which is produced in a photodiode when no photons incident on the PN junction diode. Even if photons cannot incident, still we are going to produce some current due to minority charge carriers. Such current is called as dark current. Next point. If you send one photon, you will produce some current. If you send two photons, you will produce somewhat more current when compared to the previous case. If you send some more photons, the value of current goes on increasing. The value of intensity goes on increasing by increasing the number of photons. We can show in terms of graph here. This is for intensity I1. If you increase the intensity, current also goes on increasing. So see, just from the graph, intensity goes on increasing by increasing the number of incident photons. So from the graph, I3 greater than I2 greater than I1. As intensity of the current increases by increasing the number of incident photons. And finally, the most last point which we will discuss from the graph is, by using this intensity of light, by using that intensity of light, we can detect how much energy of photons incident. Means reciprocal. If photons increases, current increases. By knowing this current, you can calculate the energy of photons incident. If A gives B, by knowing B, you can also calculate A. In such a way, we can calculate the amount of energy incident on the junction diode by knowing the intensity of light. In such a way, a photodiode is a p-n junction diode in reverse bias, where light incident to form current. So circuit contains a p-n junction diode which is connected in reverse bias, which contains a load resistance along with a micro ammeter. Whenever photons incident, electrons in valence band will jump to conduction band, creating a hole in the valence band. So electron hole pairs are formed, which produces some current. Such current is called photocurrent. This is the first reason for producing current. Second reason is by an electric field between P and N, the minority charge carriers from P, which are electrons, will move towards N. And in case of N, the minority charge carriers are holes which can move from N to P. So due to the movement of minority charge carriers, a voltage or an EMF, electromotive force, is produced. This EMF or voltage will produce a small current which flows through load resistance and can be measured by micro ammeter. And finally, from the graph, even though no photons falls on the photodiode, still we are going to produce some current. Such current is called dark current. So dark current means no photons incident, but still due to minority charge carriers, we are going to create or produce a small current. Such current is called dark current. By increasing the photons number, the intensity of current increases, which can be shown in the graph in such a way. See, with increasing photons, intensity goes on increasing. So I3 greater than I2 greater than I1. By knowing the intensity, we can calculate the energy of photons. Or by knowing the energy of photons, we can also calculate the intensity of current. In such a way, photodiode can be used to detect optical signals, to detect visible and invisible radiations, used as a to know the intensity of light coming from cameras, and also used in fanning circuits. In such a way, photodiode, in one word, converts light energy, photo means light energy into electrical energy. So up to now, we have discussed the first application of optoelectronic junction diodes, which is photodiode. Photo means light energy converting into electrical energy. We have used a p-n junction diode, which is in reverse bias. Now, the second application of optoelectronic junction diodes are nothing but LED. LED. Already we heard this word. LED means light emitting diodes. LED stands for light emitting diodes. So this is the second application of optoelectronic junction diodes. So what is LED? What is photodiode? Photodiode is a p-n junction diode in reverse bias. Photo means light. Light energy converts into electrical energy. Here LED, light emitting, means here also we are going to use a diode. So LED means we have to take a p-n junction diode which should be in forward bias. Here the p-n junction diode should be in forward bias. So what happens? LED is a p-n junction diode in forward bias which emits light. So light energy is produced. So electrical energy converts into light energy. So LED, light emitting diode, is a p-n junction diode in forward bias, where electrical energy converts into light energy. Light emitting. So you are going to produce light energy from electrical energy. Why? What is the use of LEDs? Why we have to use LEDs? Means LEDs can be used in remotes, TV remotes, all type of remoting systems. we are going to see a number of display boards outside. All the display boards which we see contains LED. Used in optical communications, light communications, to transfer light from one point to another point fastly. So this is what we are going to call optical communications. So LEDs are used in optical communications, used in display boards, used in remoting systems, used in alarms, burglar alarms. Burglar alarms which can produce sound randomly. So in all these things, we are going to use LEDs. Now, I want to raise a question. LEDs are there. Before LEDs, there are a number of lamps, power lamps, incandescent lamps. So, there are incandescent lamps, but what is the advantage of LEDs when compared to these incandescent power lamps? Why we have to use LEDs when compared to incandescent lamps? Means LEDs have a number of advantages. LEDs requires very, very low power. It requires very low voltage. It does not require warm-up time. Warm-up time means, suppose if you are going to switch on a TV, general TV, it takes almost 30 seconds to 40 seconds to start. But LEDs don't require such time. That is called as warm-up time. So, for LEDs, warm-up time is very, very low. Fast on and off processing. And the most important point for LEDs, it has more lifetime. And one more interesting point is, these LEDs will produce a wavelength of 100 to 500 angstroms. 100 to 500 angstroms wavelength, which is almost monochromatic. Mono means single, chromatic means color. Whenever there is a single color, it can travel a very long distance. So, LEDs are used more when compared to these incandescent lamps. In one word, the points which we discussed up to now is LED, light emitting diode, which contains a PN junction diode in forward bias, which produces light energy from electrical energy. Electrical energy converts into light energy in case of LED. Uses of LEDs, used in display boards, used in remotes, used in alarms, used to transfer or used in optical communications, where we can transfer light from one point to another point. Why LEDs are used? Even though there are a number of sources, even though there are a number of incandescent power lamps, what are the advantages of LED? Means LED requires very low voltage, less power consumption, more lifetime, doesn't require warm-up time, fast on and off time. And the most important point is, its wavelength is almost equal to 100 to 500 angstroms. If the wavelength is in such a way, it is almost monochromatic. Monochromatic light, laser light is a monochromatic light. So, laser can travel a long distance. In the same way, LED having a wavelength of 100 to 500 angstroms have the capability to penetrate or to travel a long distance. Hence, LEDs are used more when compared to these incandescent power lamps. Now, coming to its working, how we can generate this light energy in such a way, we can discuss all these points now. So, LED contains a PN junction diode which should be only in forward bias. So, we are going to take a PN junction diode. So, this is P, this is L, which is connected in the forward bias. So, P is connected to positive terminal and L is connected to negative terminal of the battery. Just like the last time, this circuit also contains a load resistance. There we have taken microammeter to measure current. But here we are not going to measure current. We are going to produce light energy. So in the circuit, there is no need of a microammeter. So the circuit contains a PN junction diode, where P is connected to positive and N is connected to negative, means PN junction diode is in forward bias. And the circuit contains a load resistance. Now, what happens means P, which contains holes, N, which contains electrons. Only one point which we have to know is, in P region, majority charge carriers are holes and minority charge carriers are electrons. In N region, majority charge carriers are electrons and minority charge carriers are holes. So what happens in LED is, these holes from P will move towards N. If holes moves towards N, in N, minority charge carriers are holes. Now holes are adding again. So minority charge carriers increases. In the same way, electrons from N will move towards P. When electrons move towards P, in P, minority charge carriers are electrons. If electrons from N will move towards P, minority charge carriers increases. Means, in both the regions, by transferring holes from P to N and electrons from N to P, in both the regions, minority charge carriers increases. These minority charge carriers, which are more in number in both the regions, will combine with majority charge carriers there. In P, minority charge carriers are electrons. They combine with holes. In M, minority charge carriers are holes. They combine with electrons. And automatically, whenever these holes and electrons combine, they produce a small energy in terms of light. In such a way, light energy is produced when minority charge carriers in both the regions combine with the majority charge carriers. In such a way, LED is responsible for flow of light. So just LED light emitting diode, which requires a PN junction diode in forward bias. Circuit contains a load resistance. We are not going to place any microammeter. Microammeter is not required. Why? We are not going to measure current. We are going to produce light. So light energy. Hence, microammeter is not required. So holes from P will move towards N. Electrons from N will move towards P. Then now they transfer. So, as electrons move toward this side, in P, minority charge carriers are electrons, and now electrons are going to be added. So, minority charge carriers increases. In the same way, holes from P will move towards N. In N, minority charge carriers are holes. If holes comes to this side, minority charge carriers increases. So, in both the regions, minority charge carriers increases and combines with the majority charge carriers, and whenever they combine, an energy is produced in form of light. In such a way, LEDs are used to emit light. So, light emitting diode is a PN junction diode in forward bias, where electrical energy converts into light energy. Electrical energy is nothing but a combination of holes and electrons. In such a way, we can produce LEDs. And the most important point of LEDs are, in order to produce an LED, the energy gap should be equal to 1.8 electron volts. Whatever the semiconductor substance you take, the energy gap should be equal to 1.8 electron volts. So for that sake, to produce LEDs, we are going to use two substances. One is gallium arsenide, second one is gallium arsenide phosphide. Gallium arsenide, whose energy gap is 1.43 electron volts. For gallium arsenide phosphide, the energy gap is 1.9 electron volts. So these two substances whose energy gap values are nearly equal to 1.8 electron volts. It is the most important point in LED. So to produce an LED, energy gap should be equal to 1.8 electron volts. For that sake, we are going to use the substances of gallium arsenide, whose energy gap is 1.43 electron volts, and gallium arsenide phosphate, whose energy gap is 1.9 electron volts. And one more interesting point is, if we look at the color code of BIPGER, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. These LEDs can emit red, orange, yellow, green, and blue. So LEDs have the capability to emit either blue, green, yellow, orange, and red, but not violet and indigo. Why? What is the reason? Means their wavelength is very, very small. So from blue to red, they can emit any color. Now, in this century, some researchers are going on to produce LEDs in white. If white LEDs are going to be placed. So, if this is the LED, this LED is wrapped in a cover. If it is wrapped in a cover, if it is covered by a cover, it can emit light in all directions. In such a way, an LED works. So, LED light emitting diode has a PN junction diode, which should be in forward bias, and the circuit also contains a load resistance. Holes from P will move towards N and electrons from N will move towards P. Due to this, minority charge carriers increases. As minority charge carriers increases, they interact or combine with majority charge carriers and emit energy in form of light. In such a way, electrical energy converts into light energy in an LED. To produce an LED, energy gap should be equal to 1.8 electron volts. So the suitable substances to produce LEDs are gallium arsenide and gallium arsenide phosphate, whose energy gaps are 1.43 electron volts and 1.9 electron volts. And these can emit blue, green, yellow, orange, and red, except violet and indigo. Now researchers are going to produce LEDs of white color. White is a composite color. If white LEDs are produced, we can generate any type of color from a single LED. So that is the researchers going on nowadays. And finally, we discussed LEDs have a number of uses. Used in alarms, used in optical communications, used in TV remotes, or even used in display boards. Why LEDs are used, we discussed. LEDs have a number of uses, advantages when compared to incandescent power lamps. Why? Low voltage, less power, and very fast on and off capability, and no requirement of warm up time, and the wavelength is 100 to 500 angstroms. If the wavelength is 100 to 500 angstroms, it is almost monochromatic. Monochromatic light can travel a very long distances in a very, very short time. So these are the best advantages of LED, which can be used more when compared to incandescent lamps. Just now, we discussed how LED works, how electrical energy is going to convert into light energy. So the last one on the third optoelectronic junction device is nothing but solar cell. We know what is a solar cell. So solar cell means it is a device which converts sunlight into electrical energy. Now my question is, the solar energy will absorb only sun energy. Does it take any other energy? Means yes. Energy of sunlight. Just in the same way, if you take energy of any source, both should be same. So just like the energy of sunlight, the sources having the same energy can also be taken. So sunlight, solar cell. solar cell is a device which converts sunlight or sunlight energy into electrical energy. It is works, this complete solar cell is based on the principle of photodiode. How photodiode works? In the same way, solar cell also works. So what is the use of solar cell? Means solar cells can be used as power sources, either in calculators. These are used in electrical watches, and this can also be used in satellites. All these solar cells will act as power sources in satellites or space vehicles or in calculators and so on. So solar cell can be used widely in our domestic purposes. Now coming to how we are going to construct a solar cell. In one word, just we discussed, solar cell works on the principle of photodiode, and already we know how photodiode is constructed. So we have to take a PN junction diode which should be connected in reverse bias. So P should be connected to negative and N should be connected to positive. So we have to take a load resistance, and then in photodiode we have taken a microammeter to measure current. Here there is no need of a microammeter. So the simple diagram of photodiode, simple diagram of solar cell will be in such a way, just like a photodiode. In photodiode we have taken microammeter, in solar cell there is no need of a this microammeter. So this is the simplest form. So in one word, solar cell is a device used to convert sunlight energy or the same type of energy like sun into electrical energy. So never mess with the point that always sunlight can only be used in a solar cell. It is wrong. Just like sun, the same energy can also be used to fall on the solar cell, which is going to convert into electrical energy. Now coming to solar cell diagram, which is almost equal to photodiode, but the exact solar cell will be in such a way that you should take a silicon wafer. If you take a silicon wafer, then just see. So we are going to take a silicon wafer. Silicon is a semiconductor. So this silicon wafer will contains P and N regions. So I am going to take a P region and I am going to take a N region. P region should have a thickness of 300 micrometers. N region should have a thickness of 0.3 micrometers. Why can't you place P up and N down? If we can raise such a question. See, if this is a silicon wafer, suppose if you are going to above surface as P and below surface as N. P having a thickness of 300 micrometers, which is big when compared to N. N is very small. So in order to make the sunlight to reach the lower edges, the upper surface should be very, very thin. It should not be thick. So for that sake, we are going to take N up and P down as less thickness, whose value is only 0.3 micrometer. So we have to take it as upper, and P region should be taken as down. So as the thickness is very less for N, automatically sun rays can move inside and penetrate or falls on the P region. So that is the reason why we are going to take a N region upwards and P region downwards. As N region is upwards, this is called as trench surface, and P region is downwards, it is called as back surface. So P acts as back surface and N acts as front surface, whose thickness of P and N are 300 micrometer and 0.3 micrometer. And this P is covered by a metal. So we should cover this P region with a metal. So this is the construction of a solar cell. where we have to take a silicon wrapper which contains P and N regions. N region have a thickness of 0.3 micrometers. As its thickness is less, we have to prefer it up, and the below region is P, whose thickness is 300 micrometers. As N is up, we are going to call it as front surface. As P is down, we are going to call it as back surface. And this P region is covered by a metal. Now, on this N region, still there is one more part. On this N region, we are going to take finger metallic electrodes. We are going to take a part called as finger metallic electrodes. If you see the diagram, the electrodes are in shape of fingers, which are made with metals. Hence, it is called as finger metallic electrodes. Finger-shaped electrodes which are metals. So, this part is called as finger metallic electrodes. And this finger metallic electrodes on the N region will occupy almost 15% of the area. It occupies 15% of the surface area. If this finger metallic electrodes area increases, it can absorb more sunlight. So, almost as the metallic electrodes width or length goes on increasing, the capability of the solar cell to produce electrical energy will also be more. Hence, almost this metallic electrodes occupies 15% of the area. In such a way, we can show the diagrams of the solar cell. Here, solar cell in form of PN photodiode, where PN junction is in reverse bias and it is connected to load resistance and no need of micro-ammeter. In the second part, where we have to take a silicon wrapper having P and N regions, N should be top as it is thickness is less. P having more thickness should be placed down. P is called as back surface and N is called front surface. On the above surface, we have to take a finger metallic electrodes which occupies 15% of the complete area. And this P is covered by a metal whose thickness is 300 micrometers and N has a thickness of 0.3 micrometer. So in such a way we can construct. So in the simplest form of this diagram can be shown as upper layer is N, lower layer is P, and on this N you are going to take a number of electrodes which can absorb sunlight. So this is the simplest form of the diagram by using a silicon wrapper. In such a way, by using these diagrams, we can show how the solar cell is going to absorb sunlight. Now coming to its working. So just we discussed, it is completely based on the photodiode. Just like photodiode, here also can explain the working of a solar cell very, very easily. So, whenever, if this is N region, if this is P region, and on the N region there will be number of finger metallic electrodes, whenever sunlight or any light of the same energy falls on the finger metallic electrodes or falls on the solar cell, the finger metallic electrodes will absorb that energy. Whenever the finger metallic electrodes absorb that energy, according to band theory, what happens? There lies two bands, valence band and conduction band. So, whenever sunlight falls, this energy is absorbed by the electron in the valence band and jump to conduction band. Automatically, a small vacancy is formed, that is what we are going to call hole. So, this is electron. So, in the first step, what happened? We have generated electrons and holes. So, the first step is nothing but generation of electron-hole pits. So, in step number one, what we have done is, whenever sunlight falls on the solar cell, the finger metallic electrodes absorb the sunlight. Then now that sunlight is absorbed, automatically the electrons in the valence band absorb that energy and jumps to conduction band. Automatically here a small vacancy is produced, that vacancy is filled by a hole. In such a way, electrons in conduction band, holes in valence band are generated. So such a process is called generation. Such a process is what we are going to call it as generation. How we discussed in photodiode, the same mechanism will be explained here. Next, step number two, what we are going to call it as separation. Separation. What happens here means, just assume the diagram. Separation. This is the solar cell, just like a photodiode, which is in reverse bias. In reverse bias, current flows due to minority charge carriers. So, in P, minority charge carriers are electrons. So, electrons will move to N. In N, minority charge carriers are holes. So, holes moves to P. So, all the electrons are separated to N. All the holes are separated to P. Hence, it is called as separation of charge carriers. So, what happened here? In case of P-N junctions, the minority charge carriers of P, which are electrons, move towards N. And the minority charge carriers of N, which are holes, moves towards P. So minority charge carriers get separated. Whenever they get separated, automatically these minority charge carriers will combine with the majority charge carriers, and they get to form, whenever they combine, it leads to formation of a current. In such a way, in the third step, we can collect the current, and such a process is called collection. So photosolar cell works on three steps: generation, separation, collection. Step number one, generation. In generation, what happens? Whenever sunlight is allowed to fall on the solar cell, the finger metallic electrodes absorb that energy. So the electrons from valence band will jump to conduction band. Whenever the electrons jump to conduction band, vacancy is formed. That vacancy is filled with a hole. So electron hole pairs are generated. Now, in case of P-N junction diode, minority charge carriers of P, which are electrons, will move towards N, and minority charge carriers of N, which are holes, will move towards P. So, automatically minority charge carriers get separated. Such a process is called separation. Whenever these minority charge carriers get separated, these minority charge carriers will interact or combine with the majority charge carriers of that places and automatically produces current. Such a process of producing current, which is going to get collected, is called as collection. Generation, separation, and collection are the three methods used in the working of a solar cell. Now, what happens? Whenever all the holes will move towards P side, so P completely becomes positive. All the electrons from P will move towards N side, so N becomes completely negative. So P becomes positive, N becomes negative. As both are opposite polarities, then also it can produce current. In such a way, current can be produced in case of a solar cell based on the principles of generation, separation, and collection. These three methods completely explains how we can generate current in a solar cell. Now, what are the requirements to form a solar cell? What are the requirements to form a solar cell? In order to form a solar cell, the energy gap should be between 1 to 1.5 electron volts. the energy gap should be between 1 to 1.5 electron volts, and the absorption value, thermal absorption, should be 10 power 4 centimeter reverse. The absorption range should be 10 power 4 centimeter reverse. And also, it depends upon the materials, it depends upon the cost, it depends upon the thermal capability also. But these are most important points. For a solar cell, to make a solar cell, the energy gap range should be between 1 to 1.5 electron volts. And the thermal absorption should be of the range 10 power 4 centimeter reverse. And also depends upon the requirement of raw materials, cost, along with the thermal capability. So, using these requirements, some substances which are going to make solar cells are, first one is silicon, second one is gallium arsenide, and the third one is cadmium tellurium. These three substances are used for making solar cells. Silicon, already we know the value of energy gap, which is 1.1 electron volt. For gallium arsenide, we discussed in LED, which is 1.43 electron volts. Whereas for cadmium tellurium, it is 1.45 electron volts. All the three substances' energy gaps are in the range between 1 to 1.5 electron volts. So these three substances are used for making solar cells. And one more important point of a solar cell is, for a ideal solar cell, which don't have any drawbacks, the energy gap is 1.5 electron volts. For an ideal solar cell, which don't have any drawbacks, which follows the perfect requirements, for such a solar cell, the energy gap is 1.5 electron volts. And finally, if we are going to draw the current voltage characteristics of a solar cell. So, being solar cell, which is almost equal to a photodiode, so it works in reverse biases, but still there is a change in graph. So here we are going to take forward voltage, here reverse voltage, forward current, reverse current. Up to now, if you draw in the first quadrant, it is a forward bias diagram. If you draw in the third quadrant, it is a reverse bias diagram. But in solar cell, we are going to draw the graph only in the fourth quadrant. Where it touches voltage, that voltage is called VOC, open circuit voltage. Open circuit voltage, and such current is called ISC, means short circuit current. Why we have to draw in fourth quadrant? Whenever there are first, second, and third quadrants, means why we have to draw fourth quadrant means solar cell cannot draw current. Solar cell draws current and just gives to load resistance. It does not take any current. It just receives and just gives to load resistance. So for that sake, as it is not going to absorb any energy, we are going to draw the graph in fourth quadrant, which indicates it is not going to absorb any energy. In such a way, by knowing this graph, we can clearly tell solar cell is a device which cannot absorb but can convert sun energy into electrical energy. Always sunlight cannot be used. Whatever the light we take, the energy of that source should be equal to sun. And the best substances required for making solar cell are silicon, gallium arsenide, and cadmium tellurium. And finally, the best ideal solar cell has an energy gap of 1.5 electron volts. So once again, if you recap all the points, so solar cell device which converts sunlight into electrical energy. For this, you should take a silicon wrapper, which contains P down and N up, as N thickness is less, which is only 0.3 micrometers. So this N is called front contact and P is called back contact, and the thickness of P is 300 micrometers. This P is covered by a metal, it is called back contact. On N, whose thickness is 0.3 micrometers, we are going to place finger metallic electrodes, which occupies 15% of the area, which plays a crucial role. If the width or thickness of the finger metallic electrodes increases, it is going to absorb more sunlight. In such a way, we can explain the construction of the solar cell. Whereas solar cell works on three principles: GSC, generation, separation, collection. So whenever the sunlight is allowed to fall on the photometallic electrodes, the electron in valence band absorbs and jumps to conduction band, leaving a vacancy which is filled by hole. So electron hole pairs are generated. Separation. Minority charge carriers of P, which are nothing but electrons, moves towards N. And minority charge carriers of N, which are holes, moves towards P. So minority charge carriers get separated, which interacts with the majority charge carriers and produces some current. That is what we are going to call collection. As solar cell is not going to absorb any energy, it just takes energy or it just takes current and gives to the load resistance. Hence, we are going to draw the current voltage characteristics only in fourth quadrant. And always remember the best conditions. The energy gap of a solar cell should be in the range 1 to 1.4 electron volts and the absorption range of 10 power 4 centimeter inverse. So in such a way, solar cell can be used as a power source or power supply in case of satellites, space vehicles, used in calculators, and also used in our electrical watches. So in such a way, based on the principle of GSC, generation, separation, collection, a solar cell works where sun energy is going to convert into electrical